So today I'm going to speak about continuous integration with the DevOps Cloud platform, basically show you how you can build a full pipeline of going from source to distribution using only cloud tools and platforms. So just before we begin, my name is Yoav, I'm the CTO of JFrog, and JFrog started out as an Israeli company. We have branches in Santa Clara, California, and a branch in Toulouse, France today. We have a small obsession about frogs. So we have two products. One of them is Artifactory. Who of you heard or is using Artifactory? Okay, cool. So Artifactory is a binary repository, and our other product is Bintray. And Bintray is a download center as a service, so it's a distribution platform for binaries. So you can say that JFrog business is mainly about managing binaries, basically moving files from A to B. Of course, it's more complicated than that, but that's our expertise. And the reason we're here is because someday a manager may come to you and he may tell you, I want a modern software pipeline and I want it now. And the first thing is you may wonder, wait, what is this software, modern software pipeline for developing and distributing software? And then you're going to look around and you're going to say, all right, I want to be like the cool kids. So I want to have everything automated in the cloud. And for your information, what JFrog is doing, what I'm showing you now, is what JFrog is doing in-house to distribute our own binaries to our consumers. So I'm showing you something that works in practice. So the basic specification for that would be, of course, something that is fully automated. So we want automation, but we want it to be easy. We want to have something that is enterprise ready. So apart from distributing maybe open source or community libraries, you want also to distribute proprietary software. And of course, you have control, so privacy and control auditing, who has done what and who can see what and so on. And if we break it down, If we break it down to steps, so basically we are wishing to do the following steps. First, we want a place to store our sources in. Then we want to build our binaries from source. We want to store those binaries somewhere. And we want to either deploy the binaries to production, so push them onto some runtime server. Or the other option, which is what I'm going to focus today on, is distribute your binaries to your end users. So you're doing a push and a pull. So you push it to somewhere, and then your consumers, which may be users, they may be software devices or applications that download your software as modules or plugins. So you're pushing it somewhere to the cloud, and then it's being pulled by consumers. So that's going to be our focus, the binary distribution. And when you look at this list of requirements, first thing you may think is, wow, that looks like a lot of servers to manage and a lot of services to maintain and take care of, upgrade them, make sure they are available, monitor them, and so on. So what if I told you that this is all practically possible, doing it in the cloud, as a service, everything is maintained for you. So it is. And hopefully, by now, I got you intrigued enough to bear with me through the technical details. So let's dive in and see what actual technical parts we're going to use to build this pipeline. Okay. So first, we're going to have to use a software, a source repository, a version control repository. And the options, there are plenty of options, so we can use something like GitHub or a Bitbucket, which are very, very popular, or we can use the DevCloud offering, so they offer Git or Subversion. There are pros and cons to each approach, but at the end of the day, one big advantage of having the DevCloud close to your CI is that to have the source repository close to your CI is the fact that everything is network close, so your build fetches the sources much more rapidly. So that's what we're going to use. Next, we need the CI server. So I hope I don't completely shock you when I choose Jenkins. After all, this is the Jenkins user conference, and it's a great CI server. So in with DevCloud, we have Jenkins in the cloud, nothing to maintain. It's the Jenkins CI server that we all know and love. And you have all the flexibility about plugins that you have in an on-premise Jenkins installation. Next. So next is, once we built our software, we have binaries. We need to store them somewhere. So again, we have a couple of options here. There is actually support for software repositories, binary repositories in DevCloud, which I believe is some sort of web dev around the file system. So while it may suffice for very basic needs, it's not a full-featured binary repository. And here, it lacks many capabilities that a modern binary repository management tool needs. So again, what I'm going to recommend here is the JFrog tool Artifactory, which is a dedicated, focused binary repository. And we have an online version of Artifactory provided as a service. And we also give it away for open source projects. Basically, it's a focused binary management solution. It facilitates, like we will see in a minute, reproducible builds. It has extensible metadata, which is extensively used by our customers to annotate artifacts, mark what's in production, mark all kind of quality of levels of quality on artifacts, whether they are QA ready, whether they passed QA, on which servers they are deployed, and so on, which build created them, which we will see in a moment. And again, it's a cloud service, so there is nothing for you to maintain. And the big advantage is that with Artifactory, we have a plugin for Jenkins, which is a very, very popular plugin. It's an open source plugin. It's available on GitHub. We provide it not only for Jenkins, but we started out with Jenkins. And this is, by the way, what we always do. Every new feature in the plugin, because Jenkins is so popular, and it's really easy both to develop and extend, and also to get massive feedback almost immediately from the open source and commercial community. So we always start with Jenkins, then we deploy the other features to other servers like Bamboo and TeamCity, ThoughtWorks Go, and so on. So the plugin gives you a bill of material information, also gives you information about the dependencies that are used in your build, license control, it captures environment variables. It's still, we don't lose the network proximity. So by the fact that we are using a cloud service which is not provided by DevCloud, we are still running on the EC2 US East data centers. So we are close to the DevCloud agents. And this plugin is maintained. It's one of the early plugins for Jenkins. We started with Hudson, and then we moved to Jenkins. It began its life in 2009. And it's maintained very, very well. We keep releasing new features. In fact, some of the things we will see in the demo are features that are only available in the most recent version of the plugin. So you can see that it's a very well-maintained plugin. And finally, after using the plugin and pushing binaries to Artifactory, we want to push it to distribution. So to push it to distribution, we are going to use a distribution platform called Bintray. And Bintray is our second product. It's basically a download service, download center as a service. And the reason we created it is we saw that you have this wonderful automated, fully automated pipeline from development to distribution. You have your automation with the source control, with the repository manager. Everything goes through the different phases of QA and quality gateways until it reaches the release phase. And once you need to push it to distribution, usually in very advanced companies that have a very good life cycle, which is fully automated, usually this step is neglected. So what we often see is that you start out with a download center project that there is a lot of excitement in the company around it, but at the end of the day, it's not your core business. And what happens in many companies is as this download server becomes an expert system. So there is one expert that knows how to tweak the XML files to make the release appear somewhere on the web that, so that users can download it. And I see a lot of nodding, so you probably some of you are familiar with that. So that's what we saw with many customers. This is why we decided to complete this chain, to complete this pipeline, and introduce Bintray. So as you develop a download center, usually you want blazing fast downloads using a CDN, fanatic uptime, because for your customers, it's critical that they will be able to download software no matter what. If it's down, usually you feel the backfire quite quickly. It has to be secure, has to facilitate entitlement management for downloading private software or private software packages, provide smart statistics, ability to consume logs in a way that will allow you to parse it and dice it in standard tooling, use metadata to annotate software. Of course, it has to be fully automatable through REST API, and offer advanced features for callbacks, so release hooks, notifications that you can consume securely, and so on. It has to be integrated with your CI process. And one very important thing, it's not just a dull software repository. It's not a shim over a file system or something like that. It has to provide indexes for package managers. So it has to be a smart repository manager with REST API that is expected, for example, by Docker. So we support Docker in Bintray, also for open source. So it sounds all very cool. And you may ask yourself if you haven't heard about Bintray by now. So how many, by the way, have heard about Bintray? Okay, so not a lot of people. It's quite a new service. So for your information, how many people are using a Mac? Okay, quite a few. If you use Homebrew today, everything you get, all the Homebrew battles are coming from Bintray. If you download CouchDB or Cassandra, it's coming from Bintray. So we serve the Apache Software Foundation. If you're developing Android applications and you fire up Android Studio, everything, every Android library that you get today is coming from JCenter, which is effectively the largest Java repository in the world today, which is hosted on Bintray. The Groovy language, if you are using tools by ThoughtWorks, if you're using any tool by HashiCorp, so Vagrant and Consul and all those nice tools, you download them from Bintray today. Ruby gems, all the Netflix OSS repositories, packages. So those are some examples of the open source tools that are provided on Bintray today. And you can imagine what kind of load we are taking. So it's a distributed clustered platform in Europe and in the US. And of course, you can distribute proprietary software. So we offer commercial packages of Bintray if you want to download to distribute something that is not under an open source license. So we give it if you wish to distribute open source software, even Docker images or Vagrant boxes, you can do it today on Bintray. And given the fact that Docker images are pretty big, we still provide it for you for free. It's very fast. It all goes through a CDN. If you want to use something which is proprietary, you have to buy a subscription. And again, what I'm going to show you is that through the Artifactory plugin, I'm going to be able to take my software, build it, push it to distribution, and make it available through my end users with all the nice statistics and logs and features that a distribution platform allow me to do. So three things I want you to watch for in this demo. One is that we're going to do the full cycle with basically very minimal interaction, source all the way to distribution. The other is we're going to see how the Jenkins and the JFrog tools are working together very, very nicely, and it goes for both open source and commercial. And it's all going to be in the cloud, so I'm going to use my browser mainly, even though in real life it's all RESTful, so you're not likely to touch as many buttons as I'm doing now, but it's not very demoable to do a REST API demo. So we're going to use the UI, and just bear in mind that everything is, you can fully automate it using the REST API. And with that, we're going to do the demo. Okay. So let me switch to the browser. Okay. Okay, so it looks a bit blurry to me, maybe because I'm too close to it. So I'm just going to use mirroring, otherwise I'm going to have a severe neck problem. Okay. Much better. Okay, so it's a little bit cut off. We're good. All right, so the screen that I'm showing you here is the DevEd Cloud screen. And I have a demo build here called Gradle Demo. So it's a very, it's just a tiny Gradle build. Basically, there is the source for it on GitHub, on Bitbucket, but we forked it, and because we're using the DevEd Cloud built-in Git repository, I will show you in a minute. So I'm using a trial version, by the way, of DevEd Cloud, so it's not always that responsive. So we may have to wait a little bit to get prioritized in the queue to get an agent to build. But since it's a tiny build, I think it will be okay. And this build is building snapshot versions. So let's imagine. So I have a couple of build runs. And let's imagine that at some point I want to stage a release. Okay, so I want to. So this is already configured with the Artifactory plugin, and I'm going to hit the Artifactory release staging button here. Let me zoom a little bit. Okay, so what it gives me. Basically, it gives me options to configure my release. So this is the next release version. This is what my next snapshot is going to be. And it integrates very nicely with the Git and SVN plugin for Jenkins. So it can automatically create a branch for me in Git and tag this branch with the tag. I can put a comment on the tag and I can push it to a repository in Artifactory. I will show you in a moment how that's done. So I'm going to pick the libs staging local. If I would put it on, it was on a snapshot repository, I would get an error if I try to do that because this repository will reject, I will get a 409, a conflict. This repository would have rejected my release if I tried to do it because it only takes snapshots. And I can put a comment here, so staging 122. So with that, it's going to kick off a build. So you see it's waiting for an available agent here. And once it's doing that, I'm going to go over the configuration with you. Hopefully it will finish. Even if not, I can show you the previous build I ran in order to, yeah. Okay, so it was pretty quick. Okay. So this Jenkins instance has the Artifactory plugin installed. If I go to manage Jenkins, and I think it's out of the screen for me. Oh, no. Manage plugins. Installed. So we have the Artifactory plugin installed. And if I go to the configuration of Jenkins, and if you remember, it's using a cloud Artifactory. So configure system. So let's look for the Artifactory section here. There it is. So it has the URL of an Artifactory server. This is using an Artifactory online instance used by our solution engineering. It's called the internal sandbox. So we have the username and the password. And if I test connection, it contacts Artifactory with the REST API, showing me that basically I'm on the latest version of Artifactory, which is 3.9.0. And now I'm going to go back to the build. So I didn't make any change, actually, but it thinks I did. Leave this page. OK, and let's configure this build. And let's see what we have here. So remember, this is a Gradle build, but the integration works basically for any type of build, Freestyle, Maven, Gradle, whatever. So we have the basic Devitt Cloud settings. This is the Devitt Cloud repository. So this is a Git repository provided by Devitt Cloud. So that's just the Git URL and the credentials that are automatically assigned by the key generated in Devitt Cloud. And we are reaching the Artifactory section here. So we have to select the server that we created earlier. There is only one configured in this instance. And if I refresh, it's going to go to Artifactory, and it's going to fetch a list of repositories that you can resolve from and deploy to. So here is the list of resolution repositories. So what it does here, it goes to Artifactory and gives you a list of virtual repositories that are aggregations of other repositories. It promotes a very nice usage pattern because you can have a virtual repository that encumbers a lot of physical repositories underneath. And for you, for your clients, it's transparent. You give them one URL, and they are not aware of how it's composed inside, and you can change the repositories underneath. So the plugin promotes that. And then we have a publishing repository. So there is a lib snapshots local repository for publishing snapshots. We can tell the build that it's using the Artifactory Gradle plugin. So there is an Artifactory Gradle plugin that is configured as part of the source code here. And it's already defining some settings. Capture and publish build info. This is probably the most important checkbox to have. We can filter out sensitive patterns because it's going to capture a bill of material for this build. And part of that are environment variables. And we want to filter ones that maybe contain keys and secrets to all kind of services. So publish artifacts to Artifactory. We're going to use Maven compatible patterns for this Gradle build for the release artifacts. Release management. I think we're done. So let's. After we showed the config, let's look at the output of this build. So this is the build run, and we can see that as the final step of the build, it deployed artifacts to Artifactory here, and it also deployed the build info, which I will show you now. So let's go to Artifactory. So there is a direct link from Jenkins to Artifactory here. And this puts us here in the UI of Artifactory. So that's the UI of Artifactory if you haven't seen it before. And what we can see here, we can see basically the bill of material for this build. So if you cannot read from afar, it says that the name of the build, Gradle Demo 1, build number, the version of Jenkins that built this build, the version of Gradle, so it's a quite old version of Gradle, the one who deployed to Artifactory, the principal in Jenkins that actually triggered this build. I can see the environment variables that were effective when I ran this build on the machine. So that's very important. We capture everything about the build. I can see all the published modules. So it's a very tiny build. There is only one module which captured the jar, a Java doc, a POM, and the sources. And I can see the dependencies, so log4j. Again, it's a very, very tiny build. But I have this only information at my disposal at any time. And this information effectively is just a JSON file. And this JSON file is fully open source on GitHub. This whole standard and the Jenkins, the low-level integration with Gradle, Maven, and so on is open source on our GitHub project. CI servers like ThoughtWorks Go, for example, they created the implementation, the integration with Artifactory based on that. They didn't need anything from us. They just relied on this API, which is very stable for a couple of years now. I can actually see the JSON here. And if I wanted, I could have consumed it programmatically. So it has every information that you can see in the UI you have here, and even more, with all the fingerprints of all the created artifacts, all the dependencies, which allows us to do things that, like license analysis, for example. If I go, this is quite nice, if I go to diff, so I can take a build, and so I can diff this build against a previous build. So I can see which artifacts are new, which dependencies have shifted, which environment variables were changed, and Jenkins environment. So what I see here is that all the changes are actually related to the build itself. There are none that are external to my environment. There is nothing here, but we actually integrate with the Jenkins Jira plugin, and we allow you, once you release something, to see the full history of Jira issues that were resolved as part of this build until the phase that it was staged. And if I go to the release history, I can see my comment, so staging 1.2.2, the repository, who built it, and when. So basically, it gives me a full traceability both for the build and for the release history. So I'm going to go back to Jenkins. I'm going actually to do it from the Artifactory UI. So again, there is a bidirectional relationship, which takes me back to the build in Jenkins. And this relationship goes all the way to the artifact. So I can, at any point in time, I can take an artifact and I can find out which Jenkins build created it. I didn't show it, but it's annotated with metadata, with properties that are searchable, and allow me to, even on an artifact in the UI, I can go back to the CI server that created it. So that's very, very powerful tracking feature. So the next thing I'm going to show you is I'm going to do a promotion. So I'm going to do a simple release promotion for this build. So this Artifactory logo with the small caret on top of it is going to do promotion. And this is Artifactory basically allows you to code your own promotion logic. This is the built-in default one. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to mark it as released. I'm going to put a comment here. And I'm going to select the libs releases local repository. And I'm going to run this promotion. So it's very, very quick. It actually does nothing but contacting Artifactory through the REST API and adding a new, to the JSON file, adding a new record about the fact that these artifacts were promoted. and it's going to move them or copy them if I opted to another repository. As a side note, because the Artifactory storage is based on checksum, copying artifacts is almost a zero-cost operation. We don't copy anything, we just create new references, so there is no file system copying. The storage of Artifactory is an append-only checksum-based storage, so it promotes all kinds of smart pattern usages around binaries. And if I go back to Artifactory and I check the release history again, maybe I have to refresh it. That's odd. Just one second. Yeah, that's the one. Okay, so I can see that after it was staged, it was released. And again, with my comment and the auditing information about this release. So the final step for me to do is basically take this artifact, and once it's released and it's good to go for distribution to my end users, I want to put it online and distribute it using Bintray. So I'm going to go for a moment to the UI of Bintray. So this is Bintray. Let's go to the homepage for a second. And you can actually see that people are actively pushing new artifact suite all the time. It's a very active, busy open source repository. And I'm logged in as JFrog demo. And under JFrog demo, I have a pro repository. It's a Maven type repository in this case, called pro demo. And I have a Gradle demo 1 package that I created earlier with a couple of versions here. So the latest one is 1.21, and I just released 1.22. So I have to go back to Jenkins now. So I'm going to cheat here because I'm going to use the UI, which is not something I would probably do in a normal scenario. I would just fire a REST API to do what I want to do now. And I can push to Bintray directly from here. So the first thing I'm going to check is this override descriptor file. So for your information, if I want to push something to Bintray from Artifactory, the easiest way to do it is to stick a JSON descriptor file in your source control, make sure it's uploaded to the repository as part of your binaries, and that has all the metadata that you need about your Bintray account, your repository, package in the repository, and the version, and all sort of other metadata. For example, the license your software is distributed under, the version control URL, which are mandatory if you are using open source. We allow you to sign files automatically, either with your own GPG key or the one that is built into Bintray. And I said I'm going to cheat, so I'm going to fill in this information manually now. So the subject is JFrog demo. And my repository under the subject. So it's a little bit like GitHub. You have users and repositories, but then you have packages and versions underneath. And the package name is Gradle demo 1. And the version I'm going to create is 1.22. And I don't need to fill in a license or anything because that's a private repository, so I can distribute commercial software if I want. I'm not forced to specify an open source license. And now I'm going to push it to Bintray. So what it's doing now, it's contacting Artifactory through the REST API, and it completed successfully. And in Artifactory, I actually have already configured my Bintray user and API key as part of my account in Artifactory. I can provide it also as part of the REST API itself, but it just contacts Artifactory and pushes to Bintray. So let's go to Bintray again, and let's refresh this page. So again, this is my user. This is my repository. I have a Maven repository. In this Maven repository, I have a package called Gradle Demo 1. So if I refresh the page, so I see that I have 8 unpublished items And if I go to this, so this is just a UI that shows above the file system, okay? It's all metadata. If I go to the repository, the layout of this repository is a plain file system repository, but every artifact that I upload to BinTray is associated with the version information. So if I go to this version, I go to 1.2.2, and I go to the Files tab, I can actually inspect the files. I don't know if you can notice, surely if you cannot if you sit very far away, but there is a little green dot here that says those files are basically unpublished, so nobody can see them. I could have published them right from the beginning, but this is like a chance to do another sanity check just before the files go online. So I can see that my repository, which is going to be consumed by my users, and my users can watch this repository. So in this case, I'm going to double check and see that my files are there and they are good to go. And once I decided that they are indeed good to go, I can publish them. And once I've done that, if I go back to my package, so I don't know if you noticed, it offered me to tweet it. But my recent version is 1.2.2, and my files are available now, so everyone can download them. If I go to a file, let's pick one file, just as an example. First, you see that it automatically signed those files with my GPG signature. In this case, it's actually the BinTray built-in GPG signature, so people can verify that it came from BinTray from your own account. And I'm going to take the jar file here. So this is the dependency management section. I'm going to take this jar file here, and I'm going to show it in the download list. So you see it got this small icon. And if I go to the general page, it's here, available for downloading, and I can get it through the CDN now. So I did a push directly to BinTray, and everything is available for download on a CDN. So we work with CloudFront and with Akamai today. So I'm not going to save it. So we did the whole flow. We started with source control. After we started with the source control, we built our binaries. We pushed them to Artifactory. From Artifactory, we did the normal, we simulated the normal QA lifecycle with different quality gateways until we were happy with the release. And then once we had the release, we pushed it to distribution on BinTray. That's basically it. We did everything automatically, and everything I showed you here is fully REST automatable. And with that, I think we have plenty of time for questions, because that's about it. So yeah, if somebody has any questions, I'm more than happy to answer.
If it is possible to push to BinTray directly from Jenkins, like if I have own compiler, or it's possible only via Artifactory?
Yeah, so the answer is you don't need to use Artifactory to push to BinTray. It's a lot easier because you have this JSON file, but we allow you to push to BinTray. It's just a REST API. So we actually have very good integration with Gradle, with the Travis CI, and with Jenkins, naturally. But at the end of the day, it's just a REST API call to do the push to BinTray, and you don't need to go through Artifactory. Okay. It's just a bit easier to do.
How are you doing? Thanks for the presentation. Traditionally with Maven repositories, there was a golden rule that you never delete released artifacts, but with more and more continuous integration and deployment, there's more and more builds, more and more versions. So how do Artifactory get around that issue of, you know, that you're going to have to purge something to maintain some kind of storage? Like, do you kind of have a concept of, you know, kind of moving to an archive, moving to backups and so on? Mm-hmm. What's the logic around the change of usage of Nexus, or of Maven, sorry? Mm-hmm.
Okay. So if you want to purge artifacts, so let's start with the Bintray side. Bintray is a release platform. It's a download center. It's kind of rare that you have to release to purge artifacts from your download center. It may happen, but for that you can use the REST API. And basically, if you use open source, we are kind of rigid about it. So if you have something online for more than 6 months, we will not allow you to purge it because people came to rely on that. But if you have your own repository, you're free to do whatever you want. It's your users. If you're using Artifactory, and this is where your question is probably more applicable, you do create a lot of garbage when you're doing CI. So that garbage piles up, and you have to clean it up at the end of the day. So apart from built-in features in Artifactory that allow you to clean up and purge all snapshots and all releases, you can have full control over your purge policy. So the way it works is that we allow you to extend Artifactory with your own plugins written in Groovy. Usually plugins, they are not more than 20 or 30 lines of code. There is actually a sample on our public GitHub repository for user plugins for a plugin contributed by one of our clients in the UK. I'm not going to mention the name. But what they did is they did, for example, a plugin that takes artifacts, doing a search in Artifactory for artifacts not downloaded since a couple of specified months. And this plugin can be invoked either through REST API, so we allow you to extend the REST API of Artifactory by writing a plugin. You can create your own extension points. Or the same code base, so the same method in this Groovy plugin code that you can see online, you can invoke it through a scheduled task. So another thing that we allow you is to create your own scheduled task in Artifactory that will invoke this code, do this search. If it's a dry run, depending on your specifications and parameters, it's going to print out the old artifacts. If not, it's going to actually discard them forever from the repository. And you can imagine the amount of flexibility that this allows you in implementing your own purge policy. So definitely, it's not only possible, it's also very easy. Thank you.